Hey guys, welcome back to another video. Today I'm going to be showing you how I created this lower third inside of HitFilm Pro. We're going to be taking a look at all of the layers and how I built up each of the effects, and if you're interested in the project file, you can download that in the description as well. I do want to let you know that we have a sale coming up, so if you're not already subscribed to the email newsletter, be sure to do that to get notified when it goes live. Let's go ahead and dive into the project file and see how I built this graphic. The first layer that I animated is the title box, and all that is a mask on a plane. Inside the mask properties, I unlinked the scale attribute so that I can change the X and the Y separately. And then I keyframed the X property to go from 0 to 21, or however long it needs to be to fit my name in there. The only effects on this plane are fill color to give it the dark blue. Then I have an outer glow effect, and this is how it looks when you first put it on the layer. If I turn the spread all the way up to 100, it becomes solid and not feathered. Then I can increase the opacity to 1 and lower the size as needed. Then I had a drop shadow, which may not be too visible there, but it's going to cast a shadow on the subtitle box, which is the next thing that I animated. The subtitle box is basically the exact same thing as the first one, I just used a couple different effects to give it a different look. So the set matte effect is using the subtitle layer, which is here, but that text layer is actually hidden. You can see I have the eye off. And the reason for that is because the subtitle box is using set matte, so it's taking a piece out of itself, and that piece is the shape of the subtitle text. So if I change the subtitle, the matte will change as well. Next up, I have a Light Sword Ultra glow only effect, and that gives it a nice blue glow around the outside. And then Chromatic Aberration, which is also a pro only effect. If I were to just leave it white, it might be a little bit boring or a little bit simple, so the Chromatic Aberration helps give it that extra little bit of color and interest. Next up, I have a composite shot called Dots. And you'll notice that I split things off into composite shots several times in this lower third. And the reason for that is usually because I can pre-render that composite and it will speed up my entire workflow. So these dots were all created from one single layer. What I did was I created a plane, used the fill color effect to make it white, and then made it really small using the transform properties. So you can see I've positioned it up here in the top left. And then I'll use the clone effect, which is super useful if you need to duplicate things and have them offset each time. The number of clones I've increased to the maximum amount, and then the position offset determines how far apart they are from each other. Then what I'll do is use another clone effect, but this time I'll use the Y position offset so that I can just repeat them down the screen. Then I have a grade layer, and on that grade is a reflection effect, and that does exactly what it says. It flips the image from one side to the other. And that was a really simple way of just duplicating everything I had done so that it fills the screen. So this dots layer I've made really small and then lowered the opacity and used a mask to contain it to the initial box. Next up are two corner effects. And these again are really just simple rectangle masks on a white plane. That's it, and then I just made them really small. Then we have the gradient bar, and this is just to add a splash of color to the sort of blue and white look that I've got going here. The thing about this layer is that if I play it back, you can see that it randomly twitches all over the place and it gets bigger and it gets smaller. I did that manually. So I really just went in and keyframed it. I said, at this point, I want it to be down here on the bottom. At this point, I want it to be thin on the side. Sometimes you just have to do things manually. And you can see here that I'm using the constant keyframe type, which is the square. So that means the gradient bar is not smoothly moving from one place to another. It's just snapping. And now we have the main title layer, which is where the person's first name goes. For this, I had another chromatic aberration effect to give it that red-blue shift. Then I used another glow effect to make it blue. Next up is a hue, saturation, and lightness effect. And for this, I only shifted the red channel, which is the edges here, and I shifted it 90 degrees, which means they get tinted purple. Then I have a small blur effect to smooth it out a bit. Then I used flicker and shake to give it a little bit of sort of vintage distortion. And film grain as well to give it some texture. The idea for these pluses and diamonds came from videohive.net, which is a great place to look if you're looking for references for your motion graphics. And these were done with the particle simulator, so I'll just set that up in a new composite so that I can keep this one the way it is. The first thing you need to do before you set up the particle simulator is set up the textures. So you can see I have a composite for a diamond, which is literally just two masks and then rotated 45 degrees. And I also have one for the plus, which is just a text layer. And I've made both of these 500 by 500 because they don't really need to be that big. When you set up your particle simulator, you'll want to make sure that you have the diamond and the plus textures inside that composite shot. They can be turned off, that's fine, but you have to have them in that comp. So in the particle simulator settings, what I'll do is change the shape to quad, which means the particles will be emitted from the shape of a square or a rectangle. What I did was I set this shape to the size of my lower third. Then I'll turn the speed of the particles down to zero so that they don't move. And you can see they're already starting to flash on and off. Then I'll do particles per second. And for this, I'll just keyframe it from, say, 30, and I'll have it go down to zero. So eventually they'll stop appearing. In the particle systems, what I'll do is go to appearance, it's texture source layer, and then set the source layer to one of the composites. And you can see that the particles are now using that shape as its texture. They're a bit big, so I'll make the scale smaller. And they're a bit uniform at the moment, so I'll increase the variation in the scale. If you want to increase the variation in the life or the speed or whatever, that's up to you. Feel free to do that. We've got the diamonds, now I just need to add in the pluses. I've already got my work done with the diamonds, so I'll just duplicate that and then change the texture to plus. They'll be on top of each other because they're doing the exact same simulation. Just go into general and change the seed. And that's how you have the diamonds and the pluses flash on top of your lower third in a way that appears to be sort of random. Next up, we have a composite, which is the TV damage effect. And that is just flickering lines, which eventually turn off. And I turned on electrical interference and then just keyframe the quantity to go down to zero. I also added a diffuse effect to soften them a little bit, as well as chromatic aberration. And if you find that your graphic is showing a black background, the demult effect can help get rid of that. Here's what the graphic is looking like at the moment. It's looking good, but it's still a bit clean. I want to add in some digital distortion and some glitches. So to do that, I'll create a new grade layer. The first effect I'll add is block displacement, and it does exactly what it says. It displaces blocks of your footage into different parts. I'll keyframe the displaced blocks parameter so that it isn't affecting it the entire time. But you can see it takes pieces out of your footage and just kind of spreads them out. Then I'll use the pixel sort effect. If you missed Tom's quick tutorial on this, you can find that in the card on screen. But this is really good at introducing sort of chaotic randomness. You just kind of drop it on and it works. I did have to keyframe the reveal so that it wasn't affecting the graphic the whole time. But other than that, I didn't really change a lot of the parameters. Then we have two glow effects. These are both set to add to brighten the whole thing overall. Next is a scanlines effect. So if I zoom in here, you can see the effect that has, just makes it look a bit more digital. And then I use TV damage for two effects, and that is ghosting and the monitor. So ghosting creates copies, sort of like cloning, and it helps fade them off into the distance. And then monitor is how I got that pixely look that flashes up at the beginning. And this is done by decreasing the resolution and then lowering the width as well. Similar to the mask on the gradient bar from before, I keyframe them to appear random. I didn't really have anything specific in mind. I just kind of change the number, skip forward, change it again, and just keep doing that until it looks quite random. Finally, I'll finish it off with some film grain, a small lens distort effect to just bulge out the center a bit, as well as a radial blur to soften the edges. And that's it for the tutorial. If you do have any questions about the techniques I used, feel free to let me know in the comments below. And don't forget to download the project file if you'd like it for yourself. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you all in the next video.